Hello everyone, thank you for attending today's webcast. Today I'm going to talk to you about low-code application development with the Oracle Autonomous Database. My name is Shakib Rahman, and I'm a software development manager at Oracle, where I focus on all things Oracle Apex and database tools. Today's agenda is quite simple. I'll begin with an introduction to the data landscape today and why data is so important. I'd like to talk to you about, you know, what low-code is and how you can use low-code to be a catalyst for your organization to solve problems. And finally, how you can use Oracle Apex, specifically the offering from Oracle that's part of the Oracle Autonomous Database, to build incredible applications without being an expert in computer programming or these vast array of web technologies. And finally, I'd like to give you an extended demonstration of how you can build an application using Apex. Data is often considered the world's most valuable resource. There was an article in The Economist that said that, you know, data is really the most valuable resource compared to, you know, even probably more so than an organization's employees or their intellectual property. And they concluded that data-driven organizations are far more valuable because of the insights they can get from analyzing all of the data and beat their competition. So, they made a number of conclusions. They talked about, you know, acquisitions from Microsoft and Facebook and many other companies. And they painted this picture that, you know, if you can understand the data that you have, you can be far more successful and far more profitable. So what I'd like to talk to you about today is how can you make your own insights from the data that you already have? And well, not everybody is a data scientist or a computer, you know, programmer or professional. Maybe you have some data and you know, you have some low-code platform that you have access to. How could you build an application on that data? How can you visualize that data, see that data, manipulate that data, and really, you know, get some interesting conclusions out of that data? So to do that, I'd like to begin with an introduction to what is low-code. To do that, I'd like to talk about low-code. So first, what is low-code? Low-code is, or rather, low-code development platforms are basically software. It's an application that you use to build applications using some kind of graphical UI and configuration rather than traditional computer programming. And really the key here is that you're using a UI and you're, you know, it's a very declarative approach to programming, to building applications, rather than actually going in and typing a lot of code. Now, low-code provides an easy on-ramp, meaning it's fast to get started. And this means that you don't have to be an expert to start building applications. Low-code is very productive, meaning with minimal effort, you can employ feature-rich components in an application. And it's accessible to more than just the highly trained full-stack developers, meaning it broadens the pool of people in your organization that can solve these business problems. Low-code is often scalable and extensible, meaning you're not really put into a box. You can scale to, you know, complex problems, and you can even pull in third-party tools and third-party libraries to make sure that you're able to extend your applications. And finally, it's all about rich functionality with low-code. Now, here's some reasons why you may want to use low-code. Of course, you can build apps faster. It takes a lot less effort to build these applications, so you can deliver, you know, results much faster than traditional programming. You can deliver quality, greater quality and consistency, because when you use a low-code platform, you're really using the same building blocks over and over again. So once a user has, you know, become accustomed to using, let's say, a report in your application, well, that same report is used all over the place. It has the same functionality. This also allows you to reduce development costs. And finally, the hallmark of low-code is that you can focus on business requirements. Gartner concluded that by 2024, low-code application development will be responsible for more than 65% of application development activity. This is a rather large majority of application development that will happen using these low-code platforms. So why, you may ask? They said it's because of compelling productivity gains and speed of delivery, meaning it's fast and it's productive. Forrester concluded that low-code, you know, low-code platforms are about 10 times faster than traditional methods. And I think it's actually going to be a lot faster than that. So who can use low-code? Business analysts, non-IT professionals, you know, the employees that you have, or the people that you have in your organization that are not a traditional developer role or a computer scientist role, but they're able to use low-code technologies because you don't have to be an expert in these vast web technologies to build compelling solutions. But it's not limited to just non-IT professionals or business analysts or the functional side of things. Even if you are an IT professional, you could use low-code to build fairly compelling solutions and apply the most of your knowledge, you know, your deep core knowledge, on solving really sophisticated business problems rather than everything else around a solution. If you're a database developer or DBAs or DevOps, this makes a lot more sense for you as well, because now you don't need to worry about every other component, every other facet of application development. You can focus on the business requirement. And finally, you, the people on this webcast, I believe that all of you could use low code to build very compelling solutions. So then I'd like to talk to you about Oracle Apex. What is Oracle Apex? Oracle Apex is a low-code development platform that enables you to build scalable and secure enterprise applications with world-class features that can be deployed anywhere. We have been delivering the benefits of low-code with Apex for many, many years. Oracle Apex has been included with the Oracle database as a no-cost feature since 2004. That means that if you already have the Oracle database, you already have Oracle Apex. There's no additional licensing fees, irrespective of the number of developers, number of applications, number of end users, number of database objects. And because Oracle Apex runs anywhere the Oracle database runs, including the Oracle Autonomous Database Cloud Services, you really get the best of breed for low-code application development on a data platform. So I'd like to begin by giving you an extended demonstration on how you could use Oracle Apex to build applications without really becoming an expert in all these web technologies. So for my demo, what I'm going to do is build an application on some movies data that I've downloaded from Kaggle, which is like a dataset aggregator. I've gotten about 3,000 rows of data from the MovieDB, and I'd like to build an application on this which has some dashboards, some ad hoc reporting where I can do some analysis, a faceted search where I can quickly search and filter and get to exactly the movie that I want. And then I want to show you a mobile-friendly user interface that you also get without really becoming a full-stack developer. So let's get started. The first thing we're going to do is go and sign up for our own free cloud service. Just go to apex.oracle.com and then click on the Get Started for Free button. Here, there's a nice video that walks you through exactly what steps you need to follow to get up and running in 5 minutes. So I'm not going to repeat this for this video. What I'd like to do instead is get straight into Apex. So imagine that you already have your cloud account and you've provisioned your Autonomous Database and you're running Apex. Once you're logged in, you'll see something that looks like this. Now, for the sake of this demo, I'm using Apex 19.2, which will be available in the near future on our Autonomous Database cloud services. All right, so let's go and build an application. We'll start by going into the App Builder and clicking on the Create a New App button. And the application I'd like to build today is on a spreadsheet. So I already have a file of some movies data that I'd like to upload. So let's go and click on From a File. Now, before I go and drag and drop this file, let me just show you what this file has. Here's my Excel document, which has a spreadsheet of all my movies data. Now, what I did was I went to the moviedb.org, and I downloaded a large set of data from them, about 2,800 rows of data. I can scroll down to see them all, 2,600 rows. And what I did was I tried to download the data for movies from 2000 to 2017. And this includes the title, the genre, the primary genre, the primary country where it was produced, primary production company, and then some other information like runtime, release date, the overview, tagline, budget, revenue, and so on. And with this data, well, we have enough information to go and build a fairly compelling application. We also have the poster path for this image. So this file name, in addition to a poster path URL prefix, will give us the nice poster for this image. This is the ID for the MovieDB, and this is the ID for the IMDb, or Internet Movie Database, that we can use to link to that page for more information. Okay, so that's our data. Go back into Apex, and what I'm going to do is just going to go and click on this and load that same spreadsheet file, the CSV file. All right, Apex is now digesting this file, and it shows me a sample of all the rows and columns that it's detected, and it just shows me, you know, it just parses the first 200 rows to determine all the column types, so I know that this is a date format and so on. So let's call this table movies. Okay, everything else looks pretty good here, and I'm going to go and click on load data. And what this is going to do is it's going to go and load all the data in that spreadsheet into a new table called movies, and now you can see it's complete. I'm going to click on the create application button. Now Apex will take me into the create application wizard, and while it did this, it actually analyzed my table to determine what type of pages I should have. So Apex determined that I should have a dashboard page, a faceted search page on the movies table, an interactive report where I can do my own ad hoc analysis, and a calendar because, hey, we have the release date information. So I can go and call this app something else. I think movies is fine. Let's go and change some of the appearance settings. And primarily, I want to change the application icon. Let's go into choose new icon and something that looks a little bit more like movies or something more fun. So how about this smiley face, and I'll make the icon red. Okay, save changes. Now, near the bottom here, I have a number of application features that I could also add to my application. For example, do I want to have access control or activity reporting so I can see, you know, which end users are, you know, which pages are most popular, which end users are actively using this application. There's feedback, which allows me to get feedback directly from my end users. And I can even change the UI theme as an admin of the app rather than being a developer. So let's go ahead and click on the check all button to get all of the features. And then I'm going to go and click on create application. Now Apex is going to go and create the application with all the pages and all the features that I've selected for me. All right, and now I'm dropped into the application builder tab of Apex, where I have my application right here, movies. And if I scroll down, this is all the pages in my application. So I have about 27 pages in my application. And the first thing I'm going to do is just go and run this application. Okay. And now I see my login screen. Now you'll use the same credentials you use to log into Apex. So I'm going to use my name and my super secret password. When I sign in, I see the homepage, which has some cards to navigate, and I also have a left side navigation menu, which I can hide or toggle. So let's go into the dashboard and see what we have. The first thing we see is that Apex was able to analyze that data, and it determined four charts that, you know, might be relevant to my data. So for example, here's a bar chart that shows you the count of movies by the genre. So I can see that drama and comedy and action are fairly popular, followed by adventure. I can see the movies. So in the data set that I have from the Movie DB, I filtered on movies from 2000 to 2017 in the English language, which is why you see the US and UK and Canada near the top. And here's all the production companies, so Universal Pictures, Paramount Pictures, and so on. And then a chart with all the runtimes. Now, this information is somewhat relevant, but we're going to go and tweak this in a little bit. The next thing I want to show you is the faceted search page. Now, I got this page for free with my Create Application Wizard. And what this gives me is a UI to quickly filter on different facets of my data. For example, I can find all the movies that are comedies that were, you know, produced or filmed in Canada. And I can go and add additional filters. I can do things by runtime or budget. And of course, all of this is configurable, and we'll get into that in a little bit. Now, the really neat thing about this is that this is a search similar to something that you and many of your users have probably already used. If you ever go to Amazon to shop for something, or if you're buying anything online, it's very likely that you've come across something like this. So this is faceted search. Let's go on to the third page. This is an interactive report page on the same data. So this is a basically a tabular report. And I also have an edit button where I can go open up a dialog and go and edit some of these fields. And maybe even later, we're going to go and clean up this dialog page. The idea here is that you have a lot more control over the data that you have. For example, I can go and hide columns simply by hovering over the table header, clicking on it, and clicking on the Hide Column button. There's a whole lot more. We'll get into this in a little bit. Now let's go to the calendar. Now, this will show me a calendar of the data that I have, and it defaults to the current month. What I'm going to do instead is navigate in a couple of years in the past. And now I can see the release dates for these movies. So for example, Wonder Woman came out in May 30th, 2017, and The Big Sick came out on the 23rd of June. So all this information we already had in our table, and Apex was simply able to plot it for me. Finally, there's an administration section where I can go and toggle various settings of the application, browse activity reports, and basically interact with all the other features that I checked when I created my application. We're going to use a feedback feature primarily to go and submit feedback for ourselves and then be able to review that feedback. Okay, so that's just a very quick tour of the application. Now let's jump back into Apex where I can show you the underlying data and what happened. So here we are back in the App Builder, and I'm going to click on the SQL Workshop tab. This will allow me to browse all of my database objects. So let's go into the object browser, and here I see I have one table for movies. If I click on this table, I can see all the column names, the data types, and so on. But I can also click on the data tab, and I can actually get to the underlying data here as well. So think of this as a neat little data explorer built directly into Apex. Now, of course, I can go and click on all these other tabs to see various different information. One thing that I think is most relevant is the sample queries tab. And if I click on this, this will show me sample queries for this table. So here's a very simple query that selects all the columns, but then it found some columns which are more interesting. For example, if I wanted to show all the movies by genre and how many movies there are, this would be a pretty good chart for it. Same for country or by production company. So Apex will, by default, suggest a few queries that might be interesting to your data. All right, so that's SQL Workshop. Of course, there's a whole lot more here. I can go and perform arbitrary SQL here. I can select a star from movies. If you're a SQL guru, you can go ahead and do this. Any SQL, SQL that you can write, you can enter it right here and get the results immediately. We also have SQL scripts. We have a number of utilities. I can load other data and so on. So it's a whole lot more. Team development allows you to work together as a team and manage issues together. You can assign them to milestones. You can label them certain ways and so on. So I can click on complete setup. And just to kind of give you a really quick demo, here's the first issue that I have. You can see that we can use rich formatting. I can even attach files. We can really do a whole lot here. All right. And the final tab I want to show you is something called App Gallery. Now, think of this as the app store for your Apex applications. With the product itself, we ship about 30 different packaged or sample applications that you can use immediately. And they're kind of broken down by a few different types. There's a number of productivity applications that you can use to immediately run the app and use it right away. There are some sample applications that you can use to learn about a feature functionality of Apex. For example, if you wanted to learn how to use REST services in your Apex applications, you can simply go click on this application, install it, and then see exactly how this application was built. So a really great resource that's completely built in, included with the product. So now let's go back into the App Builder, and here's my movies application again. And what I'd like to do is start by customizing the dashboard page. And the first thing we're going to do to customize this page is simply go and change this genre chart to be a pie chart instead of a bar chart. Now, to do that, we're going to have to go back into the Apex application builder. And how do we do that? Well, there's a few different ways. At the very bottom of your screen, there's something called the developer toolbar. And this is what I can use to quickly navigate into the design time or the builder view of Apex or the runtime. So what I'm looking at right now is the runtime view of my application. It's just as if any end user were to run this application, except they wouldn't see this black developer toolbar at the very bottom. So I can go to the homepage of Apex, I can go edit this application, I can go edit this page, which looks like what I want to do. But actually, if you go further to the right, there's something called Quick Edit. Now, if I click on this, I can hover across different components of my page. So these are all the regions. And a blue outline will appear around that region. And if I click anywhere in that outline, I'm going to go straight into Page Designer to be able to edit that component. And if I click on this little spanner or wrench icon, this will open up the Template Options dialog where I can change the appearance of this region component live during the design time view. So there's ways of modifying the application in both views, but typically you're going to go into the designer view. So let's go and click anywhere in this blue outline, and Apex will now load up Page Designer. And Page Designer is really, it's a fully integrated development environment for modifying your pages. When you first load it, it may seem a bit daunting. That's because you're not familiar with it yet. The first thing I like to do to simplify this UI a little bit is go to this menu button and click on the Hide Empty Positions menu option. And what that's going to do is simplify the page layout so it hides all the kind of positions on the page or the components that aren't really being used. So now what I see is an abstraction of my page. I see a breadcrumb region at the very top, and then I see content. In my content body or my page body, I have four regions for a genre, country, production company, and the runtime. Okay, so now let's go back to the runtime just to show you the similarities. Here again is my page, the runtime view, and I see the four regions, genre, country, production company, runtime, and this is my breadcrumb region. It just happens to be the dashboard is the parent breadcrumb entry. So there's no child pages for this. Okay, so now let's go and change this genre chart to be a pie chart. So again, I'm gonna go up into Quick Edit, click on the region, and now I see my chart. So let's say movies by genre, and I'm gonna click on the attributes node on the left side, and this is the rendering tree. So it shows me all of the regions and I can modify various properties. So this is my chart, and on the far right, again, it says it's a bar chart. So let's change this to pie. And now I see all the different options that I have for my pie chart. For example, what title I should provide, what layout width and height, what type of data cursor there is, so on and so forth. What I'd like to do actually is just to show the label of the pie slice next to it. So now we're going to click on the series. And then back in the property editor, we're going to scroll down to where it says label. And currently it's going to display the percentage, but I'd rather see the label so I see the genre next to the pie slice. Now there's a whole lot more settings here. I can configure the position of the label. I can set the link, which is already set up already from the wizard for me, and so on. If I scroll up some more, you can even see the actual underlying SQL query that's powering this chart. So it's simply selecting genre, an account, and grouping by genre again, and then ordering. All right, so now let's go and save and run this page. So I can click on this blue button right here at the far right-hand corner, and that'll save my changes, reload my application, and now I see my pie chart. The next thing we're going to do is update the runtime chart so it's a little bit more meaningful and easier to understand. Currently, it's showing you the number of movies that have a certain runtime. So there's 92 movies that have a runtime of 100 minutes. Not all that meaningful. Quick edit, click on the region again. Now we're back into Page Designer. From the far left, we're going to click on the series, and I'm going to change the SQL query right here. So you can see that it's ordering by the number of the count of the duration. Let's instead order this by the runtime, and I'm not going to order it descending. So I can see the breakdown of movies from, you know, very few minutes or 0 minutes all the way to the maximum. Okay, Now, if I scroll down a bit more, I can see the maximum rows to process. Now, for optimization purposes, you may want to set this to a set number. For right now, I'm just going to remove this. Now let's go and save and run our changes, reload the page, and now this looks far more interesting. I can see the actual bell curve of the runtime. So you can see that very few movies are below an hour, and then they kind of peak at around, 92 minutes, an hour and a half, and they start trailing back off again. So a very interesting chart. The next thing I'd like to show you is how you can have multiple series displayed on a given chart. So let's show a chart that shows you the revenues and budget for movies by genre. So let's go back into Page Designer. I'm going to click on the Edit Page button. And to create a new region, there's this area at the very bottom of Page Designer called the Component Gallery. And if I expand this a bit more, you'll see all of the components, or all the region components you can have. I'm going to simply click on the chart, click and drag this onto my page. Let's call this region genre by budget and revenue. And the location, I'm going to set this to local database. And this is the first time I'm going to write any code from scratch. And that's going to be a simple select statement that's just going to give me the average revenue, average budget by a given genre. So let's type in select genre, average budget is av budget. From movies, group by genre. Okay, and I'm also going to order by one. That way they're alphabetical. Validate my SQL, I can click on this little handy button. Let's click on OK. And now let's go and set these series. So the first series is going to be budget, and it's going to be based on the region source because we've already defined the query here. The label will be genre, and the value will be average budget. I'm going to right click on the budget series again, and I'm going to duplicate this so that I have another series. Now go back to the name, this will be revenue, and the value is simply going to be average revenue. Now I'm going to save my change. Let's go back to the previous tab, reload. I can scroll my page down, and now I can see the average budget for a given movie and the average revenue that this movie earned. So in the animation genre, you can see that the average budget for movies was about $89 million, but then the average revenues were more than three times that, $333 million. Let's make a few final changes before I move on to the next thing. So I'm going to go back into Page Designer by clicking on the Edit Page button. And now I'm just going to reorganize some of the charts. Let's move runtime up here, and genre by cost and revenues over here. And the country chart, I'm going to turn this into a pie chart as well, so it's a little bit more interesting. Then again, let's go set the label to display as the label itself. Now we can go and save and run our page. And now we get a nice pie chart. All right, now let's go on to the report page and show you what we can do here. Now, this is again the interactive report component of Apex. So I can do all sorts of things. I can search for a movie. For example, I can type in Matrix and I can see the two Matrix movies that have come out since 2000. I can simply close or remove that filter. I can go into the actions menu. And there's a whole lot here. But first, let's begin by cleaning up the chart and removing the columns we don't want to see. So the poster path column, I'm simply going to click on that and hide this. I also don't want to see the IMDb ID. So far, so good. Let's go and create a group by that shows us the revenue and budget by genre, just like we did in the chart. So I can click on Actions, Group By. So the first column will be the genre. And what I'm going to do here is let's get the average of the budget and also the average of the revenue. And if I apply this, now I have that exact same chart that I built earlier, but I have the actual raw values without writing a single line of code. And I can see all the data right here, but you know what? Let's also see the same thing with one more thing. Let's add the average vote as well. So let's take the average of the voting average, show this. And now I can see, hey, here's the genre, here's average budget, the revenue, and the vote. And let's go and sort this by the highest average vote. I can do descending. So documentaries had the highest average rating. You can see their budget and revenue counts here. So that's a simple group by, but what if I wanted to see exactly this information, but now based not broken by genre, but by production company? I can simply open this up again, and let's set the group by column to production company. Huh, now it's quite interesting. And let's set the sorting by the average revenue. So average revenue. And now you can see which production companies typically have the highest average revenue. Now, another way to look at this same information is I can do a sum. So let's do the sum of the budget and sum of the revenues. So Walt Disney Pictures, that's a very large number right here, followed by Universal and Paramount and so on. Okay, and if I like this information, what I can do is I can actually even save this. So I can go to Report, Save Report, and I can call this Group by Production Company. I can give it a description, and I can even make this a public report because I'm a developer right now, and anyone else that's running this application can go and access. So I'm going to just simply save it, so it's just for me, and now I have my custom report saved. So if I go back to my primary report, I can reset this. Things go back to the way they were. I can go back and see my saved report from earlier. The other thing you can do is you can also create your own charts directly in this interactive report component. So let's go and create a chart. And the chart will simply be based on the genre and maybe the count. So let's see how many movies by genre. Okay, you can see the drama and comedy are the highest. I can go back to my data view. But now what's really interesting is I can create filters on other columns here. So let's say I create a filter where I say the average vote must be greater than or equal to 6. Now I go to my chart. You can see that, you know, hey, there's quite a few drama movies, but if I uncheck this, now I can see the ratings change. And if I want to change this value, let's go set this to less than or equal to 3 or 4. Now I can see, hey, what are some of the worst movies out there? And you can see that a lot of them are, you know, not too many of them to begin with, but action, then horror, then comedy. And I can change this chart as I like and see different data. So now that I have the data that I like or the way that I want it to be, what else can I do with this? So let's go back to the report view and explore some more of this actions menu. So I can go and download this data in any of these formats. So I can get an Excel file, I can get an HTML file, I can even get this sent to me in an email. I can also subscribe to this exact report. So I get emails daily, weekly, or monthly giving me the latest export of this data. So there's a lot of functionality here. And this is just something called the interactive reports component of Apex. Now let's move on to something that's even more interesting and even more friendlier for end users, something called faceted search. When I created the application in the first place, I got this faceted search page, which allowed me to filter on a number of different facets, such as genre and country and so on, and I can see the data on the right. What I'm going to do now is create a faceted search page from scratch on the same data, but this time make it a little bit more visually interesting. And in order to do that, we're going to go back into the Apex application builder. And this time I'm going to click on the application button from the developer toolbar. And this will take me into my application page for this application. So here's all the pages that I have. And let's go and create a new page. And this will be a report, which is a faceted search report. And let's call this movie cards. Okay, and I'm also gonna create a breadcrumb and I'm just gonna call it movies. Let's also create a navigation entry in the navigation menu. And now I'm going to select my table, which is the movies table. And I want to display this as cards. And for the movie title, for the title card title, I'll select the title. For the description, I'm going to pick the poster path because I want to show an image. And in the additional text, let's here display the maybe the production company or the genre. The genre is fine. Actually, production company is maybe better. And what type of facets I want to select. So I can check all the boxes for all the facets. So let's do maybe the voting average. I think that sounds pretty good. Let's go and create that faceted search page. All right, my page is now created, and I'm going to just run the page just to show you what we have. Okay, so here we have a faceted search page. I can see all the cards of my movies. I can see the movie title. I can see the poster path prefix, also the production company, and I have all of the facets from before. So if I only want to see comedy movies, from the UK, here they are, and maybe only those produced by BBC. However, let's make this a whole lot more interesting by showing the poster directly within the card. To do that, we're going to go and click on Quick Edit and hover over the cards and click anywhere here in the blue outline. This will take me back into Page Designer with the search results report active. And now, if I open up the columns, there's a few different columns here which are visible. One of them is the card text column. And this is where I want to show the image for the poster. So to do that, I'm going to go and update the HTML expression for this. Let's simply expand this. And let's type in image source equals. And I have the path prefix for the movie database. And then I'm going to append to that the poster path. Now, the poster path column is available to us in this report, and it's right here, you can see. And I can reference that by using the pound sign notation. So pound sign, poster path, pound sign again. And then let's give this a title in case you are not able to load that image. So let's call this title poster. And let's also give it a style of max width 100%. That way it doesn't get too big and it fits within that card. Okay, let's close the image tag. And now I'm going to save and run this page. And here we go. Now I can see the image posters right away. So I can, check other production houses. I can see more movies. So let's see, not just by the UK, but other movies produced by these production companies. I can clear these filters. And right now, the sorting is happening by the movie title, right? So I can see 10, 12, and so on. What if we can show these by the voting average? So again, let's go quick edit, click on that. And in here, I'm going to order by vote average descending. Let's go run the page again. Much better. Now we see our movies ordered by the voting average. So the highest score movies or highest rated movies are at the very top. Now again, of course, I can go and add some filters so I can see all the comedy movies, from the UK and so on. But if I click on these movies, nothing really happens. So let's go and change that so that when we click on a movie, it will open up the IMDb page for this given movie. Again, we're going to go back into Quick Edit and click on this cards region. And if I open up this SQL query, I can see that the card link is currently null. I'm just going to update this. So let's go and add in the prefix and then concatenate that with the IMDb ID. And then let's validate our SQL. Oh, hold on a second. What's going on? Oh, right. I don't need to have the pound sign. Much better. Let's go and save this, save and run. And now I see my pages again. But now if I click on a movie, for example, let's click on In Bruges, it will take me straight to IMDb, where I can learn a lot more about this movie. So let's go back. And now what I'd like to do is update the UI of this page so it's a little bit more easier to use. So currently we can see three movies side by side, but there's a whole lot of space on this page. Let's show a fewer, or let's show the movies, the card to be a little bit smaller. So now we're going to use Quick Edit again. And this time I'm going to hover over this region, and there's this spanner icon that I mentioned in the very beginning. We're going to click on this to open up the Live Template Options dialog. And this allows me to change the template options for the region as well as the you know, the component it is, so like the report or the list and so on. So if I click on Attributes, here are all of the template options that I have available to me for the cards UI. If I want to learn a whole lot more about this, I can simply open a new window to apex.oracle.com/UT for Universal Theme, which is the name of the UI framework. And if I go to that page, I can click on Components, and I can go to Cards. And here I can see a number of different variations. For example, you know, here's a featured look, here's a compact, basic. And I can also see all the template options that I have available to me. You even see sample SQL queries you can use and a whole lot more. So let's go back to our application. And what I'm going to do here is simply show more than three columns. So let's show instead five columns. So we have a lot more data at our disposal. And I'm going to not even show the initials because we have these little initials here, but they're not all that meaningful. So let's not show this at all. And I'm not going to apply any colors because there's no need for that. I could display a subtitle and show something, but I think even that's a little bit unnecessary. So this looks pretty good. I think I like the way it looks. I'm going to save this, and that's it. I've saved my changes back to the database. The next thing we're going to do is update the search field so that it's not, you know, to the left where all the facets are, but rather it's near the very top of this cards. So in order to do that, we're going to go and edit the page and then create a new search item and hook that up with the faceted search. So let's go back into Page Designer. To do this, the first thing we're going to do is create a new region in the breadcrumb bar position. So click Create Region. Let's call this region Search Container because it's actually not going to be visible on the screen. Now I'm going to set this to blank with attributes because it's just a blank region, just really just a placeholder. And right click on this region that we just created, create page item, and now let's call this search movies. And I'm going to scroll down and set the template to be hidden, meaning we don't want a visually, you know, we don't want a visual label on the screen. We want it to just be a text field. Let's go apply an icon. So search. All right, and the placeholder will be search movies. So far, so good. I'm also going to modify some template options. Now, previously I did this on the screen live, but here we can also do it in Page Designer. So let's make this all stretch. Let's set the size to be extra large. Looks good. I believe that's it. Let's go and see what we've done. So now I have movies, and then I have a search field to actually search for my movies. Now, the few things I'm going to do, the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to actually hide this title. I don't think it's necessary and it doesn't really add a whole lot. We're going to add some spacing here so that it lines up with everything else. And then we're going to finally map it so that when I search over here in the top field, it actually performs a search in the faceted search region. So let's go back to Page Designer. And this is go and delete this breadcrumb region. Right click, delete. Okay, now let's go and set up the search so it works with the faceted search. So I'm going to click on the P7 search facet right here from the facets list. And under settings, you'll see input field is set to top of faceted search region. But instead, I want that search facet to be based on an external page item. I'm going to set that. Okay, now we've mapped it. Let's add a little bit of padding here. So I'm going to select the region. And for CSS classes, I'm going to type in padding SM, which will add a small amount of padding. Now, where did I find this class? If I go back to the Universal Theme sample application, and if I go to the reference section, there's an entire section called layout modifiers. And this will show you all of the CSS classes you can use for adding paddings and margins and spacing things exactly as you like. So I can use this formula right here, or padding SM, to add 8-pixel padding throughout that region. Okay, and that's what I've done right here. Let's go and save and run this page. And now it looks a whole lot better. Now let's go and clear our filters and perform some search to see how it works. So let's type in matrix. I can see the matrix movies from the 2000s. I can type in lions to see all the movies that have the word lion, or Lionsgate, for example. And I can type in Batman to see all the Batman movies. And I can also go and clear my search to see all of them. The next thing I like to do is enable batch changes for these facets. So whenever I make a change here, I'm going to show an apply button so that I don't reload the page or make AJAX calls unnecessarily. This can be especially useful for slow running queries or when you have a lot of data and you want the user to explicitly apply these changes. So let's go back into Page Designer. And from the faceted search region, click on the attributes and then turn on batch facet changes. Let's go and save and run our page. And now, when I select a facet, for example, see all the drama and action movies, I will see a new apply button. And this will show up even across multiple facets. So let's say all the action movies, action adventure movies produced in the US, apply changes. And now I see all of them, and then the counts get updated. Another thing that might be fairly handy is to disable these counters, especially for an expensive query or when you have a lot of data. Let's go and turn this off. I go into Quick Edit to the faceted search region again. And let's go to runtime. Let's say we want to turn off the counts for runtime. I can scroll down. And under list entries, it says compute counts. If I turn that off, it's going to no longer show me those counts. So let's do the same for budget. And apply changes. And now you can see that the counts are no longer there. The last thing I want to show you is how you can display the current active filters at the very top of your faceted search region. So let's go back into Page Designer and go to Attributes, and under Show Current Attributes, Show Current Facets, just simply set this to Yes, and you can even show the facet name. Now I set this to On, and I can see exactly what I'm searching on. And sometimes you may not even want to see the facet name because it's so obvious. In this case, Action Adventure USA, I can check different production companies, apply my changes, and I can see all of my facets, and I can see all of the actual movies that match those filters. Now there's a whole lot more we could do. We could hook up with external data sources. We could even retrieve the exact same information from the MovieDB API itself. But we're running out of time, and there's one more thing I want to really show you, and that is dark mode. So let's say that you have your application, and it's a nice application, but I feel like the movies would really pop if they were on a darker background. And the way we're going to do that is by going into something called Theme Roller. Now I went to the home page so I can show you how you can customize it. So let's go and change some of the accent colors of our UI. I can make it red or really any color. And you'll notice that as I move around my application, the colors are preserved and the theme roller opens back up again. So I can go to the reports page or really wherever in my application. But what I really want to do is go to the dark side. So simply change your theme style to v.dark. And accept this because I changed the red color. And now I have this nice dark UI theme style. So let's set this as the current theme style. I'm going to close out of Theme Roller. And now my application is rendered in dark mode. And what's really nice is that the movies really pop now. I can collapse my menu, I can scroll down, I can view additional facets and filters. I can really do all of this. And the best part, all of this works on your phone. It's a responsive application that really works on any device. And it's all powered by the, the best data management platform out there. And now you've built an application within maybe, just a few minutes, 30 minutes or so, that is fairly compelling, that would compete against anything else out there. All right, now let's go back to the slides. Now, I'd like to revisit some key attributes of how Oracle Apex works. As you saw in my demo, what I was able to do is rapidly develop something, customize the application, develop, customize, and finally deliver it, right? I was complete. And really, this is because we use a number of pre-built controls for security, authentication, database interaction, validation, session state management, reporting components, and many other built-in functionalities that enable you to go from prototype to production in minutes, like we did. Out of the box, we got a very modern, intuitive, accessible user interface that really works on any device. So you can build compelling apps out of the box without becoming an HTML5 or CSS guru, right? Let us do all the hard work for you. I also want to talk to you about how Apex can shield you from disruption in the industry. So here's a number of questions asked on Stack Overflow for a number of competing JavaScript frameworks or technologies. For example, Vue, Meteor, Backbone, Redux, Ember, Knockout. These are just a small sampling of some of the most popular frameworks to come out in the last several years. And just look at the disruption that's happening here. For example, Meteor had quite a rise in 2015, but now it's kind of slowly dying down. The same with Ember and Backbone and Knockout. But if you look at Vue, it's kind of going up, right? It's getting more and more popular. And then Redux is, who knows? Maybe it's on its way out. But what would happen if you wrote your application using some of these technologies, and now they're no longer relevant? They're no longer being maintained. They're no longer being supported. And really, it's no longer active. And what happens with Apex is that you are shielded from this disruption. So we use many third-party libraries in Apex, but we abstract the majority of them from our users, such that when an upgrade to jQuery has to be made, we can do this behind the scenes and your applications continue to work. Now, I'd like to give you a brief timeline of the Apex product. Apex has been around for quite some time, since the initial release of HTMLDB 1.5 in 2004. There's been 19 releases with 200 plus major features. But the key thing here is that there are zero required rewrites. You can take an application export from HTMLDB 1.5, or really any subsequent release, and then apply it to the most current version of Apex, import it into the most current version of Apex, and the vast majority of your application will work exactly as it did before. Now, some of the UI might have changed. We have some new components. There's some migrations that we will perform for you. But because Apex is a metadata-based model interpreter, there's no code generation happening here, that it's still running today. I really believe that this is what embodies low code. Oracle Apex is 20 times more productive than hand coding. If you were to try to build a chart on some projects, in Apex, you'd probably just do a simple select star from project, or simply just select the project's table, versus writing a whole lot more with JavaScript. And now, with the Oracle Autonomous Database and Oracle Apex together, you really have this unparalleled combination of superior data management and proven low-code application development. Not only do you get this pre-configured, fully managed, secured environment to build and deploy applications, but you also get this proven, in industry, across industries, across geographies, this low-code platform that allows you to really take advantage of the data that you already have and build new solutions, solve business problems. And by the way, there's no need for you to manage any of this. Oracle takes care of all the configuration, the tuning, the backups, encryption, the scaling. All of that is managed by Oracle, so you are free to solve on solving your business problem. And the final slide I'd like to show you is that there's really limitless potential here. There are no constraints or limits on the number of applications you can build, the number of database objects you can have in your applications, or the number of developers or end users that may access or develop your applications. This is unlike many other low-code technologies out there, where they are charged often by month, by user, by month, by developer, by named user. There's none of that. It's simply, you know, an all-you-can-eat buffet of being able to build the best applications that you have on the best data platform that's available. So how do you get started? The new always free cloud service from Oracle is running on the Oracle Generation 2 cloud, and this is the real deal. It's perpetually free, meaning it's free for as long as you want to use it, and you get a lot of a lot of our best stuff completely free. For example, you get two databases, 20 gigabytes each. It supports both autonomous transaction processing and autonomous data warehousing. You get two VMs with 1 gig memory each. You get 100 gigs of block storage, 10 gigs of object and archive, networking, load balancing, notifications, emails, and this is available to all new and existing cloud accounts. So you can sign up for this simply by going to oracle.com/free. Now, to learn more about Apex, you can go to apexoracle.com, and this is where you can find all the getting started material. You can find tutorials and videos, success stories, use cases. Everything you wanted to know about Apex, you can find at apex.oracle.com. The mission of Oracle is to help people see data in new ways, discover insights, unlock endless possibilities. And I believe that using the Oracle Autonomous Database and Oracle Apex together, you're really able to do this. And I hope that I was able to demonstrate to you how, you know, within the short span of this webcast, we were able to go from absolutely nothing to a fairly compelling application in no time. So thank you so much for attending today's webcast. I'll be available for a few more questions. And of course, you can watch the replay of this later if you missed a few points, or if you just want to go back and watch it again. All right, thank you very much.